Second part. Okay, we have some questions. So, what does the first question is what does scalable mean? So it's a very difficult questions. So scale is a scalable is a derived from scale. I think many of you are so familiar with this word. The scale is a for example, so you have a measuring something, the length of the some for example, your some sleeves. So you have some instrument like this. This is called scale. And also you know fish. So each fish has some very small some skins, and so small so very thick and so solid one. So this is also called scale. So scale means something like this type of some so actually it's very difficult to so define so some so unit of the measurement. And the scalable is a stands for the this so scale, the word scale. So the scalable means so for example, so I have mentioned in my lectures, so if you are solving the problem using one CPU in 100 seconds. And so if you have a 100 CPUs using and so you can solve 1 second. So this is called very scalable. So sometimes even if you use 100 CPUs, so you need 10 seconds. So that means you have only 10 times improvement. So in this case, so this is also scalable because you have improvement. But if you compare these two cases, so this one is more scalable. I'm not sure this answers your questions, but usually we use this word scalable in this way. Okay. Does that make sense? Okay, so another question is it possible to let other universities other than NTU to have access? So this is a very another difficult questions. So basically, so Japanese trading law doesn't allow us to provide our supercomputers for so-called non-residents. Non-resident means who are not living in Japan. Okay. So, for example, we have some international students. So, I have some international students from Taiwan. So, in that case, so after 6 months residence in Japan, so they are considered to be residents. So, they can use our systems. And also, we have some, for example, there are some faculty members, Japanese faculty members in National Taiwan University. So their nationality is Japanese, but they are not non-resident from the viewpoint of the Japanese law. So in that case, they cannot use our supercomputers. But in several cases, in several exceptions, we allow to use. So one case is also research agreement. So under some types of the research agreements, so they can use although they are non-resident. So for example, our universities has some research agreement with the National Taiwan University and National Central Universities. So I think there are some students from both universities, so they can use that. So I understand that this is a lecture course hosted by NCTS, National Center for Theoretical Science. So So we are now trying to so think about some research agreement of the NTCS. So in that case, so if you are enrolled to the so NTCS program, you can use our supercomputers. But so this is another so very political issues, not the technical issues. So I'll talk to Professor Wang later on these issues. So hopefully, students in this class can use our supercomputers later. Okay, so let's go to the next part, so main part. So this is a finite volume code. Okay. So how many of you are so Fortran programmers? Any Fortran programmers? No? Oh, it's sad. Okay. Oh, you too? Okay. How about that? So most of you are so C. Okay. Okay. So we have so two kinds of the so materials in Fortran and in C. So mainly I display the so material on by the C programming language, but the layout of the so material is so exactly same as the Fortran one. So if you are the Fortran programmer, so you can so browse the materials in Fortran in your screen. Okay, so this is so I think you have already so download your the code on your PC. So, oops, just a moment. Okay, so I'll show you the so very brief overview of the finite volume code. And so last Wednesday, so you have already learned the very introductory part of the so finite volume method. And so I'll skip the detail of this part. So so mainly of the first half of the material. So target of this part is ICG solver for sparse matrices derived to the finite volume application. So FVM stands for the finite volume. And so parallelization on a single node of the readable shoe using OpenMP. So the data placement and the reordering are some very important issues. So keywords are the finite volume method, sparse matrices, and the ICCG. So this is a target application. So this is a very simple 3D Poisson equation. So this is a second order partial differential equations. So these equations has a very similar features, like the heat conduction, steady state heat conduction, and also steady state statics, solid mechanics. So finite volume method can handle the arbitrary shape meshes, and so it's so-called a self-centered. And so sometimes it's called a direct finite difference method. So we apply the several boundary conditions, and so finally the derived equations are solved by preconditioned iterative solvers, conjugate gradient, and preconditioners. In this case, IC, which stands for the incomplete Cholesky factorization, is applied. So this is a so target problem. It's a very simple shape, and also the very simple boundary conditions. So this part, F, is something like a so heat generation term. So it's so some function of the location of the cells. And also at the top of the surface, we apply the so-called Dirichlet boundary conditions, where pi equals zero at this surface in the purple color. Excuse me. So we had a very structured 3D mesh. So, but the internal data structure is unstructured. Okay. So we have also NX and NY and NZ meshes in each direction, XYZ directions. And so we have a so uniform size of the meshes. So we can change the so size delta x, delta y, delta z in each direction. But so mostly, so we are using some unit cube where all the lengths of so edges are one in this class. Okay, so this is a volume flux. So it depends on the so locations. And so I believe so you have already learned about this. So in this so applications, we have so this XYZ arrays where so they show the so location of the so each mesh in each direction, I0, J0, and K0. So the value of F is a so summation of these three values. So that means so if it's close to the so origin, the value of the F is very small. But if it's very away from far from the origin, so this part provides a so larger numbers. So this is a very fundamental issues for the finite volume method. So in the finite volume method, it's a so conservation of the fluxes through surfaces. Okay. So this is a so some governing equation for finite volume method. So the so this first part shows us some diffusion. That means the interaction with the neighbor. And so this second part is some volume flux. Where the phi is so value of the some potential, and the S is some surface, and the D is so length between the cell centers, and so V is a volume of each so so finite volume, and the Q or Q dot is a volume flux. Okay. Okay. So I think many of you are so familiar with so our finite difference method. So how many of you have learned so finite difference method before? So raise your hand. No? But actually, so you learned last Wednesday. Okay. So this is sometimes so called so this is a Japanese word in Chinese language. So it's a so macroscopic so differentiation. Okay. So basically, so this is a so microscopic differentiation, but in this case we have a so certain length of the mesh length. So in this case we have some approximation using some macroscopic differentiation. So it's very easy. So if we have a so 2 point, just a moment. So I and I plus one. So in at this point, so you have a phi I and phi I plus one, so respectively. So if we want to calculate the gradient at the center point here, so you just apply this method to calculate the so gradient or differentiation. So phi I plus one minus phi I divided by delta x. So if the delta x is very small or so close to zero, it's a true differentiation, but so as long as it's so some certain so finite length, it's a macroscopic differentiation. So, but anyway, so you can apply this type of values. So if you apply this as a first order differentiation to the second order differentiation, which we are using in the so Poisson equations, so we just repeat the same operations. So in order to apply the so second order differentiation at this I point, so we can so apply the so second order differentiation so as a further differentiation for the first order differentiation like this. So this is a so second order and second order. So finally we get this value. So this is a very so famous so so equation for second order differentiation of the finite difference method. Okay, so this is just a repeat. So the next following so pages shows that this so formula is exactly same as the so second order differentiation in the finite difference method, which I just showed. Okay. I think I can skip this part because you have already run last Wednesday. So we start from the so Fourier's law, and so apply the so same so formula for the finite volume method, and so divided by V, And so if you focusing on the first part, so you get this value. So because in this case, we have a so uniform length of the cell, cell lengths and cell surfaces, so you can put just a delta H like this way. And so finally, so you get this formula, which is exactly the same with the second order differentiation in the finite difference method. So you see, so these two formulas seems very different, but actually, so it provides the same answer. Okay, so that's just I want to say here. So anyway, so we are constructing the finite volume applications based on this formula. Okay, in 3D case, this is some conservation equations for certain cells. So because this is a cube mesh, so we have six surfaces. So that means we have six neighbors. Okay, so among between each of the six neighboring meshes, we have conservation. So we have six terms for each neighbors, and so also this is a fluxed. Okay, so this slide is very important. So because this provides a conservation laws, and for this 3D problem. Okay, so this type of the equations is valid for each mesh or each cell, and we have n meshes, so we have n such relationships. So each equation shows some types of the linear equations. So you can see that these value of the phi are all unknowns to be solved by the finite volume applications. So you can get this type of equations where the I cell is the target cell, and phi k is a neighboring cells. Okay, so you can divide these equations in two parts. Okay. So the first part is for the I cell, this is a diagonal part, diagonal component of the matrix. And also another part is the off-diagonal part of the matrix. So usually you can write this type of equations in A phi equal F, where A is a matrix which includes the diagonal and the off-diagonal components. Okay, so this is a very typical sparse matrix. So this one is derived by the finite element method. So this is the same. So this is also the case with the finite volume case. So generally speaking, finite element and finite volume method has such a sparse matrices. Sparse means we have many zeros. So in this case, for example, if you are concentrating on this seventh mesh, seventh node, seventh vertex. So they have several neighbors. Okay, for example, it has no direct relationship with this 13th node. So we have just zero here. So this large X means non-zero off-diagonal components. Okay. So you can see most of the matrix components are zero in this case. So in the case of the finite volume, so we also have very many zero components. So in the case of the 3D, we have only six neighbors. Six neighbors means we have only six non-zero off-diagonal components in each row of the matrix. Okay, so that is a very sparse matrix. Okay, so in this type of application, storing all components using the 2D arrays is not efficient for sparse matrices. So in the case of the finite volume method, we have only six non-zero off-diagonal components for each row. So even for the very complicated finite element method, so the number of the non-zero off-diagonals per each row is roughly 100. So if the number of the unknowns is 10 million, 100 million, so if we you store all the so components of the so this square matrix. So you need the so order of the 10 to the 16th words. But the actual non-zero component is an order of the 10 to the 10th, 10 billion words. Okay, so you see, you can see the so millions of orders. So that means so if you increase the number of unknowns, so this so difference is larger and larger. So 10 to the 16 words means so 10 to the 17th bytes for the double precision. So that corresponds to the so 100 petabyte. Okay. So because so K computer has a so order of the 1 petabyte. Okay. So that means so we need a 100 systems of K computer to store whole thing. But in the case of the so 10 to the 10th, so that means so order of the 100 gigabytes. So each node of the so read push U includes that so 20,565 gigabytes. So that means only a single node of the read push U can store these values. Okay, so that means so if you want to solve the so sparse matrix, so you just so keep the non-zero, really non-zero component. Okay, so in order to do that, so we introduce a compressed raw storage. So it's called a CRS. And I think you have already learned about this last Wednesday. So I just briefly overview. So basically, so the matrix vector so multiplication is a very fundamental operation in the Clio-Italian solvers. So basically, so you have to do some types of the dot product for the, so this row of the matrix and this vector. And so you get some answer of these components. That means so you have to, if you have so n unknowns, so you have to repeat n such computations. So each row has so roughly 2n operations. So n multiplies and so n, actually n minus 1 plus. So 2n computations. So we have so n such computations. So that means so order of n square computations. So if we, n is larger, so this n square is very large. So in the case of the so sparse matrix, most of the components are zero here. So zero times something is zero. So the so key point of the, this compressed row storage is that just extract the so, components corresponding to the non-zero so octagonal components. So that's a so very important part of the, this compressed row storage. So thus you can so reduce the number of computations. So if you do this in the so square matrix, so you need the, so for example millions of the so operation per row. But in the case of the finite volume, so you just need 6 operations per node. So that's a very important part. Okay, so this is the C computations. So in the case of the so so this type of the 2D matrix, it's very easy. So you assume so every component has some kind of values. So you have a, so this type of the, so double nested loops. So thus you can easily get the so computations. It's very straightforward. But in the case of the compressed row storage, so you just store the non-zero components. So this is a examples. So this is a some so matrix. This red part is a diagonal component, and this blue part are the so non-zero off-diagonal components, and white part are all zero. Okay, so in this case, so you so store the diagonal matrix, diagonal component and the off-diagonal components separately. So in the case of the ICC solvers, so we have further separation for the upper triangular part and the lower triangular part. But so anyway, so this is a case. So this part is also diagonal part, and so this is also off-diagonal part. So compress means so you just ignore so this really zero part. So this process is called compressed raw storage. So we have some arrays for index. So index means some number of the non-zero off-diagonal components for each row. So if you calculate the non-zero off-diagonal components for each row, it's a 2, 4, 2, 3, 4, 2, 4, 4, like this way. So index 0 starts from 0, and so 0 plus 2 equals 2. 2 plus 4 is 6. So you can accumulate the number of the non-zero off-diagonal components so using this index. So that means so index 8 is 25 in this case. So this 25 is the total number of the non-zero off-diagonal components in this matrix. Okay. So you can utilize this type of values in the computation. Okay, so this is a sequential number starting from 0 to 24. We have 25 non-zero off-diagonal components. Okay, so item and AMAT. So AMAT is also actual values of the non-zero off-diagonal components. And also item is also corresponding column number. Okay, for example, we have 25 components. As for the 6 components of the non-zero off-diagonal components, so the value is 1.5. And so the column number is 4 in this case. And as for this 18th component, so value is 2.5, and so this so column number is 2. I think I should use this one. Okay. This one and this one. Okay, so using this arrays, so diagonal, index, item, and AMAT, so we can operate the matrix vector multiplication in this way. Okay. So you have two nested loops. So the outermost loop is from the 0 to n. That means these are each row. So in each row, we have a non-zero off-diagonal components from index I to index I plus 1. Okay. And so this is parameter k, so corresponding AMAT k and item k provide some column number. So we just extract the non-zero off-diagonal components in this way. So that saves the memory and the amount of the computations. But memory access is more random compared to the original configurations. So that provides another problem. But currently, you don't have to care about that. So this is a very brief overview of the CRS. Matrix storage. So next part is also large-scale linear equations in scientific applications. So this part is very important. So solving x equal b is a very expensive and important part for various types of scientific computing. So we have many types of methods. So it's a very important area of research. My main research area is how to solve these equations. Okay. So classified into direct method and iterative method. And also, we have two types of the matrices, coefficient matrices. One is the dense matrices derived from the global coupled problems, such as the boundary element spectral method. And also, we have sparse matrices. So it's a locally defined problem. Such as the finite element and finite volume or finite difference method. So in this class, you are focusing on the sparse matrices. Okay. So we have two types of the method, as I mentioned. One is a direct method. So it's something like Gaussian elimination or LU factorizations. So in this case, we compute EBUS directly or doing some equivalent operations. So it's a very complicated operation. So good point with the direct method is that it's very robust for a wide range of applications and good for both of the dense and sparse matrices. And but news is that so generally it's more expensive than the iterative method from the viewpoint of the memory and CPU. So as for the iterative method, so yeah, starting from some initial vector and the iterative method obtains the final converged solutions by iterations. Okay. So we have also two types of the so iterative method. One is a stationary method. So the typical method is SOR or Gauss-Seidel or Jacobi, and I think you have already learned about that in undergraduate. So generally, this is very simple, and it's very good for how the so solutions can be obtained iteratively. But so generally, so the convergence is very slow, and it's not practical. So usually, we don't use this type of problem, this type of method for real-world applications. On the contrast, non-stationary method is widely used for various types of applications. So we introduce some kind of restriction or optimization condition for the so very fundamental iterative method. So usually it's called a Kirilov subspace method. So we have several methods. The typical one is a CG, which stands for conjugate gradient, by CG stub or GMLS. Both of the by CG stub and the GMLS are so invented rather recently, so 30 years or something. So good news for the iterative method is also less expensive than direct method, and especially in the memory, and very suitable for parallel and vector computing. The bad news is also it's also iterative method. So convergence strongly depends on the problems and type feature of the problems, boundary conditions, or some condition number of the quotient matrix. So sometimes it doesn't converge. So that means so we cannot solve the problem by iterative method. So in order to tackle this type of problems, precondition is very important. So this is a very key technology for the so parallel finite element method or parallel finite volume method. I mean the parallel applications. Okay, so I just skipped the, so this so Kirilov subspace method. So it just says what is a Kirilov subspace. So I just skipped this part. So next part is a conjugate gradient method. So this is a very important method. And so most popular non-stationary iterative method. And so I believe you have already learned about this so algorithm last Wednesday. So I just briefly overview the so this part. So this is only for symmetric positive definite SPD matrices. But so many of applications so consist of this type of matrix. So that means so we can apply conjugate gradient method for a wide range of the applications. Okay. So algorithm is so based on the steepest steepest descent method, and so x equal xi minus 1 plus alpha p. So where xi minus 1 is so solution at the previous iterations. And so P is called some vectors, so which describes the search directions. Sometimes it's called so gradient vectors. Okay. So alpha is some coefficient. So the fundamental algorithm for the conjugate gradient is a so solution of the x, so which minimizes x minus one transpose A. Multiplied by xy minus 1. Okay. So where y is the exact solution. So this is a so definition of the so positive symmetric definite matrix. So So this corresponds to these conditions. So if x equal 1, this value is equal to 0. Clearly, so next page shows the procedure of the conjugate gradient. So you can see this is very simple. Okay. So you see the program itself later. So if you just write this type of program in C or Fortran language, you just need 30 or 40 lines. It's not so difficult. So we have several fundamental operations, matrix vector multiplications, and dot product, and the so-called DAXP. DAXP means double precision operations using AX plus Y, some vector operations. Here, so this X, I is a vector. So this type of case is a scalar. Okay, so this is a matrix vector multiplication. So this is a dot product. And these are the DAXP. Okay, so next, the following pages. So I just show you the derivation of the conjugate gradient algorithms. But I skipped the detail of this part because you have already learned this material. So I just show you, pick up some important part. I just skip this part. There are some nice property of the conjugate gradient algorithms. So first one is if the gradient vector is P, and P and PI and APJ, where I is not equal to J, so all this combination, the dot product is equal to zero. That means PI is always perpendicular to APJ. If the I is not equal to J. So this type of the relationship is called a conjugate. Okay. So the name of the method, conjugate gradient, derives from here, because P is a gradient vectors. So all gradient vectors are conjugate. So this is because we call this method a conjugate gradient method. So this is very important word. And another relationship, there are two relationships here, but the first one is very important. So Ri and Rj perpendiculars. Because R is equal to B minus Ax, so it's a so-called regular vectors. So that means every regular vectors are perpendicular to each other. So in n-dimensional space, only n sets of the orthogonal and the linearly independent regular vector Rk exist. Okay, so this means conjugate gradient method converges after n iterations if number of unknowns is n. Okay, so this is a very important features of this conjugate gradient method. So actually, conjugate gradient method was invented early 1950s, so 60 years ago from now. So at that time, everybody was very surprised because conjugate gradient method assures that every linear equation can be solved in n iteration where the unknown is n. But if we try to apply this method for the real problems, it's not the case because generally we have some round of error sometimes affects the convergence. So that means this orthogonality relationship is destroyed. So in actual case, sometimes Ri and Rj are not perpendicular. So in the simple case in this class, it's orthogonal, but usually it doesn't matter. Okay, I just prove this conjugate and orthogonal relationship using a mathematical induction. So I just skip this part, but if you are interested in So you can so check all things. Okay, so this is so final procedure of the condensed gradient. So utilizing these methods. So this is very simple and easy. Okay, so next part is the preconditioning. So convergence rate of the iterated solvers strongly depends on the spectral properties, such as eigenvalue distribution of the coefficient matrix A. So eigenvalue distribution is very small and eigenvalues are close to one. So in this case, it's very good. So it's a some thing like identity matrix. So in the ill-conditioned problems, condition number. So it's a ratio of the maximum and minimal eigenvalue if A is symmetric. If the condition number is large, the problem is ill-conditioned. So precondition M, so generally its properties are similar to those of A. So this precondition M transforms the linear system into the system with a more favorable spectral properties. So this type of M is also called as a preconditioner. So M transforms AX equal B into the A dash X equal B dash, where A dash is M inverse multiplied by A, and B dash is equal to M inverse multiplied B. So if M is close to A, that means so M inverse multiplied A is close to the identity matrix. So in that case, it's a very ideal condition. So generally, so we can so multiply M inverse from the both sides of the right hand side and left hand side. So this is a overview of the preconditioned conjugate gradient solvers. So only difference between the this one and the original conjugate gradient solver is that this red part. We have a new part solving mz equal r. So this is the only difference. So preconditioning is a solving some kind of the approximate computations. So we need to compute z equal m inverse multiplied r. So because m is equal to very close to a, so m inverse is also close to A inverse. So this M inverse is some kind of the approximate inverse matrix. So ultimate preconditioning is actual inverse matrix. Okay. So if M equal A, just apply the A inverse instead of M inverse. So in this case, this is corresponding to the direct method. So you don't have to solve the problem iterative method. On the contrast, very weak preconditioning is a so-called diagonal scaling. This is a very simple but weak. I believe next page shows the diagonal scaling or point Jacobi. So instead of the original matrix A, we just extract the component, diagonal component of the original matrix D. So in this case, you can calculate the inverse matrix very easy. Okay. So this provides a very fast convergence for very simple problems. But so it's not so practical. So instead of that, we apply the incomplete factorization in this class. So typical case is ILU0 or IC0. So this is a widely used preconditioner for sparse matrices. So ILU0 is called incomplete LU factorization. And IC is also incomplete Cholesky factorization. So incomplete Cholesky factorization is only for the symmetric matrices, which are used in this class. So this is kind of an incomplete direct method. So in this class, we are mainly focusing on the sparse matrices. So even if the original matrix is very sparse, inverse matrix is not necessarily sparse. So that means originally there are many zeros, But so if you calculate the inverse matrix, we have many non-zero components. So this type of components, so from so it's changing from zero to non-zero. It's called fill-ins. Okay. So ILU zero or IC zero is a so incomplete factorization, where we don't allow any fill-ins. So that means so ILU zero and IC zero has a so same non-zero pattern with the original very sparse matrices. Because if you apply the fill-in, so you have more memory, and also you need more computations. So in order to avoid these situations, we control the so generation of the fill-ins. So the ILU zero or IC zero, zero means that no fill-ins. Okay. So in this case, you have the same non-zero pattern. Okay. So I think you are familiar with so full LU factorization or LU decompositions. So it's a direct method, A inverse or equivalent matrix of A inverse is calculated directly. Okay. On the contrast, ILU factorization is an incomplete LU factorization. So as I mentioned, generation of the fill-ins is controlled. So it's used for the preconditioning method. So it's an incomplete inverse matrix and a weaker direct method. So IL0 includes no fill-ins, as I mentioned. Okay, so I just show you that, so how to solve the matrix so by full LU factorization. So the idea of the so LU factorization is as follows. So this A is an original matrix, so it can be dense and sparse. Okay. So these are so factorized into two parts, L and U. So A is so defined as a multiplication of the two matrices, L and U. So L is a so lower triangular part of the matrix, so you can see that all the diagonal components are one, and so lower part of the, this diagonal part has some values. But all values in the upper part is all zero in the L matrix. On the contrast, U matrix has some kind of the components in the diagonal components, and so upper part so against so diagonal part has some values. But on the contrast, there are no values or all zero for the lower triangular part. So this is some features of the LU factorizations. Okay, why this is useful? Because if A is defined by A equal LU, so first we can solve the problem LY equal B and get some answer of the Y. So after that, so you can solve the equations by ux equal y. So if you solve this problem, you get some kind of x. So this x is a solution of the ax equal b. So the proof is very easy. So because ax is lux, and ux is y, so it's ly. So we define ly equal b, so ax equal b. So actually, so this provides a very important solution. Actually, so solving ly equal b and ux equal y is very easy. Okay. Excuse me. So solving ly equal b is called forward substitution. Because so ly has a very special features. It's a lower triangular matrix. So the first row has only so first row is the first equation has only one unknown. Yi is equal to by. Y1 is equal to B1. So in this case, so you can solve the problems very easily. Okay. So in the second row, so we have two unknowns, Y1 and Y2. Okay, like this way. And we have already solved the Y1. So just move in the so right-hand side, so you can easily get the Y2. So So if you repeat this type of operation until nth row, so because in each row, so you can get the solution by just using this way. So you can finally get the solution very easy. Okay, so if you have this type of L, the solving L y equal b is very easy. Next part is u x equal y. Okay, so it's a little bit complicated compared to the previous part, but it's almost the same. So in this case, we apply the so-called backward substitution. We start from the last row. So last row has only one unknown here. But so in this case, the coefficient is not one, so some kind of other value, unn. But it's not so difficult. So xn is just solved by yn divided by unn. OK, so in this case, we start from the n, and so descending order computation is applied. So thus, we can get xn minus 1 to x1. Okay. So if you have this type of LU factorization, so you can solve the problem very easily. Okay, the problem is how to calculate this LU factorization. So I skipped the detail of this part because so probably you are already learned before in undergraduate. But so in this case, I just show the very simple result. So how to solve the this factorization. So basically, so you eliminate the each row and each column one by one in this way. So you can get components. Okay, so I'll show you some examples for the case of the 5-point stencil in this case. Okay, I think it's time for a break. So I just check the answer. Okay, so you have one answer. So I'll answer the question in the first part of the next class. Okay, so let's take a 10-minute break.